हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू दी एनसिस मैकेनिकल एपीडीएल ट्यूटोरियल सीरीज फॉर फाइनाइट एलिमेंट एनालिसिस प्रॉब्लम्स। सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू सी द बेसिक जीयूआई इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ एनसिस मैकेनिकल एपीडीएल एंड देन वी आर गोइंग टू सॉल्व ए वेरी सिंपल प्रॉब्लम ऑफ a bar, okay, which is axially loaded and held fixed at one end. So let's get started. Okay, this is the GUI of ANSYS mechanical APDL. Okay, I have launched this directly from the start menu ANSYS, and then by going to this ANSYS mechanical APDL. So this window opens. So let us have a quick lookout for the GUI. Okay, GUI has a utility menu in which all your file, in which normal save, open operations, import, export, geometry operations are possible. Then there is select, in which various entities you can select. Okay, there is component manager. Okay, so lot of selection options are there. Then in the list, we are going to get the list of all these things. So let's say there are key points. Okay, how many key points are there in the model, how many lines are there, how many areas, volumes, nodes, etc. We will get them in a list manner. Okay, plot is we will be able to view them on the GUI screen. Okay, then plot controls are the options from where we control certain options like numbering of the key points, numbering of the nodes, some more view settings. Okay, then if you want to capture the image, if you want to transfer the image from the other format, okay, we use this. Work plane is when we want to create, let's say, different coordinate systems, we want to transfer between coordinate systems, so local coordinate system, global coordinate system, all of that we can do from work plane. Okay, similarly, parameter, okay, if we are trying to use some other parameters, okay, so we can have that data mentioned over here. Then there are certain specific tasks like macros which we can execute. There are certain menu control options and there are help. So that is what the utility menu. Then you have these toolbars. Okay, so this is a toolbar section. So some common toolbars you will readily find, out of which this is command prompt. Okay, wherein you can directly run the ANSYS APDL in a batch mode by directly writing commands. Then this is a very important toolbar button which says raise hidden. So many times what happens, okay, some pop-up windows are opening and they are hidden, okay, and you tend to feel that the software has hanged in between, but at that time it is always better to click this raise hidden button. So this is toolbar. Then you have this main menu, okay, in which the entire stuff is stored at. So it has the preference options, then the pre-processing stage, solution and processing stage, post-processing stage, and some other charts and histograms and everything, how we can create. Then there are some other options. Then this is the pan, rotate, zoom option, okay, toolbar, which is readily given so that you can rotate your model accordingly. And then this is a graphics window wherein this is the place where all your geometry, mesh, post processing activities will be available. Okay, so now what we are going to do is we will solve a very simple case of an axially loaded bar. So this is, let's say, an axially loaded bar with 5 kilonewton the axial load applied at the end point over here. Okay, end point over here. The total length is 1000 millimeters. Cross sectional area is 1100 square millimeter. Okay, 1100 square millimeter. So say rectangular cross section. So okay, we will see how we can make this rectangular cross section area of, let's say, 1100 square millimeter. Then length is 1000. What we will do is we will set up a geometry. Now this is a one dimensional problem. This is a one dimensional problem. So we will create, we will generate this with the key point and element method. A key point and element method. So we will first create the geometry, then we will mesh the geometry. Okay, then we will apply certain boundary conditions. We will apply the loading conditions. We will solve the case, okay, test case, and then we will post process the results. So it's a very simple task. So let's get started with this. So first thing that we will always do is we'll come to this file menu and say clear and start new. And if we are going to start with a fresh analysis, we will always say do not read file. And it show it again confirms whether we don't want to read any file from the database and start with a new database. So we will say yes. Then we will change the job name. So this is very important. Okay. So I will say axial bar. Okay, so I have changed the job name, which you can see over here, axial bar. Got the wrong spelling, axial bar. Okay, axial bar. Then the third option is change directory. Okay, so it is always advisable to store your programs at a desired location. Okay, at a desired location. So I will store them, let's say, somewhere here. Yeah, in this folder. And then I will change the title. See, the title will appear in my all plots, okay, at the bottom. So it is always good to give title. So axial bar analysis. Okay, subjected to axial load. Okay, so with this we are ready to begin the operation. So first thing is we are going to select the preferences. So now as you can see, these many types of field problems can be handled by ANSYS, so it is very powerful tool. Now if we are not selecting any of these, okay, all these options will keep appearing, so it may be distracting sometimes. So it's always better if you know the field problem in which you are working to select the particular field. So right now we know that we are working in the structural field because we are doing axial bar analysis. So the structural field I have kept it on. Discipline option, since the version which I am using, okay, only allows me to work with H method discipline, so it is by default selected. I'll say okay. Now the first thing is I will go into the preprocessor, and the first thing that I will do is select the element. Okay, select the element. So what element I am going to select? I will click on add, edit, delete. I will click on add. Now I am going to solve a, this is axial bar even though we are saying, but it's a beam problem. Okay, so we will select a two noded linear element. Okay, two noded linear element. So two noded 188, beam 188, this is the name of the element. Okay, even though the element is three dimensional, okay, the analysis which we are carrying out is one dimensional analysis, so we have to design the element in such a way that we have to design the geometry in such a way that we get the required output. Okay, so this beam element, two noded beam element, is three dimensional in nature. The thing what do I mean by that is, okay, I have all degrees of freedom present on each node of this element. Okay, so if I want, I can also create a higher dimensional geometry and use the same element, but now we are going to create a one dimensional geometry and use this element. Okay, just to reduce the computational work. So I will just say okay, beam 188, close this. Now it doesn't require any real constants. Okay, so we are not going to specify any real constants. Okay, real constants needs to be specified for link type elements. We'll go to material properties. Okay, we know that the beam is made up of steel material. Okay, so only two things are required. So for that purpose, material model number, structural field, my material is linear, my material is elastic, and my material is isotropic in nature. So this EX stands for Young's modulus. So now I know that the Young's modulus for steel is 2 × 10⁵. So I can write 2E5, and PRXY is the Poisson's ratio. Okay, so I know that Poisson's ratio is 0.3. So there are no default units as such in ANSYS mechanical APDL. Okay, the unit consistency as a user we have to maintain. So remember, in this particular problem we are going to use force which will be expressed in newtons and length will be expressed in millimeters. So having said that, this Young's modulus, the unit will become newton per millimeter square. Okay, so it is 2 × 10⁵. I have written it as 2E5, and Poisson's ratio is a unitless number, so it is 0.3. I'll say okay. Okay, this appears over here, which you can cross check. Okay. Now we don't want density thing to switch on, because as I said, we are only going to showcase the one dimensional nature. Okay, in this particular field problem. So I'll just close this. Now I was saying, okay, the use of this raise hidden button. Let's say by mistaken I click somewhere here, or let's say at the utility menu if I click, and now if I try to operate any other options, as you can see, even though I'm clicking, but nothing is appearing. And one might wonder that the software has hanged itself, but software has gone hang mode, but it's not the case. Just the pop-up menu has gone behind the main window. So for that we just have to click on raise hidden. The pop-up menu which was hidden, it reappears, and then we can properly close it, and then the software is still working, so it is not hanged. Okay, then material properties we have entered. Okay, the next thing is we need to mention the sections. As we have seen in this problem, it is a rectangular cross section, so we'll go to sections. Since the element type we have selected is beam, so we'll go to beam. And we'll go to common section. There are certain common sections which are specified. So let's say section A1. Okay. Now the section A1, this particular section we want. This is a rectangular section. Okay. Now based on the cross section area, we can find out the section. Okay, we can find out the section properties. So let's say okay, it is going to be 1100. It has been said. So the breadth and height is going to be 110, and the height is going to be 10. Okay, so in this way, the total 1100 cross section can be achieved. Okay, or in other words, we can also keep it as 111. You can preview this. Okay, so the cross section looks like this. Okay, 111. Okay, cross section looks like this. Now the thing is, this is what the 100, okay, across the horizontal axis, and this is the vertical axis, is 11. So the centroid is at the center of this cross section. Okay, and let's say we will apply this and say okay to close this. We get all the information as all the moment of inertia, area moment of inertia, okay, shear centers, everything we get. And the next thing is, we are going to create the geometry. So we'll go to modeling, create. We are going to follow the key point and element method. So we'll first go into the key point. We'll say inactive coordinate system. Okay, we'll number these points. Okay, so the first point I want at 0, 0, 0. So this is x, y, z coordinates. Okay, x, y, z location in the active coordinate system. Remember, active coordinate system by default is world coordinate system, okay, which has an origin at 0, 0, 0. So we'll start from the origin. I'll say apply. Okay, so apply will create the first key point here. And then I will specify the second key point location at 1000 millimeter apart. Keeping in mind, this is the origin, okay, 0, 0, 0, and this is going to be the, the open end, which is 1000 millimeter apart. So this is going to be the origin, 0, 0, 0. This is going to be the opposite end, 1000, 0, 0. So that is why 1000, 0, 0, key point number 2, I'll say apply. So two key points got placed. I got their numbers as well. Key point number 1, key point number 2. So I have created two key points. The next thing is, I will create the lines, or I will join them by lines. So I'll go to lines in active coordinate system. I'll first select the first key point, come to the hover to the second key point, and then again select it. Okay, the line will appear, and that's it. So we have joined these two key points with the help of line. Now, by mistake, let's say if you scrolled in between, so you are not able to see the line. So is the line got deleted? No, it is not got deleted. Just have to come to plot, okay, and just say multiplots. So when you say multiplot, okay, the line reappears. Now you will see that there are no numbers. So in order to view the numbers, you can go to plot controls, go to numbering, and you can switch on key point numbers, and you can switch on line numbers, and say okay. Then everything will be visible again. So now if you try to zoom in, zoom out, now it stays. Okay, now it stays. So that was just the I'll switch off this. Then I'm going to do the meshing. Okay, I'm going to do the meshing. So I'll go to meshing option. Okay, I'll go to size controls. I'll go to manual size, I'll go to lines, and I'll say pick line. I will pick this line, and I will say element divisions. So I'll say I want to divide this beam into 10 elements. Okay, 10 elements. So 10 elements means total mesh size would be 10 elements, and there will be 11 nodes created. So I'll say okay. Now the discretization parameter has been applied. As you can see, the element or the line got divided into 10 elements, but it is just a discretization. Still the meshing is not done. So this is a discretization parameter applied. Now we have to mesh this. I'll go to lines, I'll select this line, and I will say okay. Now as you can see, it again got converted into one line, but now it's a meshed line. So in order to see the mesh, again go to plot control, numbering. Now this time we will switch on the node numbers, and here element numbers. a element attribute number is element number, and say okay. Now as you can see, the numbers, okay, at the edge of the each line, okay, small line, are the node numbers, and numbers which are at the center, okay, numbers which are at the center of the line are element numbers. So as you can see, numbers at the center of line are element numbers. Now key point number 2 will be given key point node number 2. Okay, so in that sequence the node numbering will continue. Now we have also meshed the geometry. Now the next thing is we have to come to solution. Okay, we will make sure that analysis is static analysis. We can do all these type of analysis, but right now we are going to do static analysis. We will go to define loads, apply structural displacement on key points. So I have to say this is my fixed support, okay, the left node, if node number 1 is my fixed support or key point number 1 is my fixed support. Okay, so normally what we do is, if we have created key points and then lines and then meshing the geometry, I will select here key points. If you are directly creating nodes, you can directly say here nodes. Or generally, if you are dealing with 2D or 3D geometries, then we can say accordingly lines, or let's say areas and etc. Okay, so normally in 1D analysis, it is key points. So I'm selecting this key point, say okay. Now all degrees of freedom are constrained. Okay, so all degrees of freedom are constrained with zero displacement value. So zero displacement means it is fixed support. Okay, it is fixed support. I'll say okay. So as you can see, appropriate symbol appears indicating that it's constrained. Okay, now the right end is open. Now on the right end, okay, I have a force to apply. Okay, so force, again I will say on key point, I'll say over here, I will select the second key point. Okay, and fx, okay, now fx going in right direction is considered as positive, fx going in left direction is considered as negative. So we need to apply the force in the positive direction, so that is 5 kilonewton. So you can say 5e3, that is 5000 newton or 5 kilonewton. Okay, so as you can see, the arrow also showcases over there, okay, indicating the load has been applied. If the arrow disappears, you can again go to plot and say multi plots, and you will see the arrow. So we have applied the force, which is 5 kilonewton at the rightmost end, and it's an axial force. Now the model is ready. We can do the solving. So we are still in solution, and here you can have the option to solve the geometry, to solve the analysis. So we'll solve for current load step. To current load step, it just again confirms whether you want to begin the current load step. So let's say okay. Now it is going to solve this problem. You can say solution is done. Okay, it's a very simple problem. Okay, solution will be available within a fraction of a second. Now our problem is solved. Now the next thing is, we need to find out the results. Okay, so for that we will go to general post processor. Okay, results are not going to appear over here. You have to bring the results. You have to create the results. So for that there is post processing activity. So in that post processor, the first thing what we can do is, we can see deformed shape of the beam. So you can click on plot results, deform shape, and say deform plus undeform, and say okay. So as you can see over here, okay, this is the deform shape of the beam. Okay, it's not pretty clear because it is in the same direction, deformations are in the same direction. So what we will do, we will go to contour plot, and we will go to nodal solution, and in that we'll go to nodal solution, DOF solution, and displacement vector sum, and say apply. So now as you can see a very minor displacement. Okay, the cross section of the beam is 1100 square millimeter, and the load which was applied was 5 kilonewton. So it has produced maximum deformation of 0.022727 millimeter, and maximum deformation is on the rightmost element, which is the free element. Okay, now since we have also applied a cross section, so we can have a cross sectional effect getting considered. So for that you need to go to plot controls, style, size and shape, and just switch on this display of element shapes based on real constant descriptions. So I'll say on, and don't change any values, so that it will show, it will be showcased at a scaled value in which resolution you are viewing this. I'll just say okay, and as you can see, this is the way cross section got adjusted. If I just rotate this, okay, this is the way it adjusted itself. It always adjusts itself in this particular way. Okay, so this is the XY. Okay, this is the XY plane. Okay, this is the YZ plane. So the cross section is getting created in the YZ plane by default. Okay, now this is the total deformation which we are able to see. Okay, total deformation which we are able to see. We can also view the animation for this. So for that, you can go to results viewer. One more pop-up window will open. Choose an item. So we'll select DOF solution displacement vector sum. We'll say animate results, and animate results for the deformed results. So I'll say okay, and DOF solution, and use sum. I'll say okay. Now the scale is slightly exaggerated. Okay, remember the displacement is only of the order of 0.022 something mm. So the results are slightly, the post processor, okay, exaggerates the results so that the user comes to know that there is some deformation. And what is the deformation that we have to see from the value? So the deformation is happening in the axial x direction in which the load is applied. So this is just confirming the result. We'll stop this, go back to the normal screen, and in order to get the values, because as a matter of fact, we are also interested in what are the values at various locations. So for that, we have list results. So in list results, we will again select the similar thing, nodal solution, DOF solution, and displacement vector sum. Okay, and it gives us the values of the displacements, okay, at all the nodes. So node number one has zero displacement because it is fixed. Okay, node number two is actually the extreme right node. So that will have the maximum displacement. So 0.22727 into 10 raised to minus 1, okay, is the maximum deformation which is on the rightmost node, that is node number 2. Okay, so this is the maximum deformation which is present in the problem. Okay, so I hope you have understood this. This was a very simple task just to introduce the ANSYS Mechanical APDL GUI and solve a very basic axial bar problem. Okay, we have had only 10 elements. We can have more than that. Okay, but in subsequent this tutorial series, we will see more complex problems of creating geometries, meshing the geometries, and of course how to view various post-processing activities. So I hope you have enjoyed. Stay tuned for more such content. Till then, thank you very much.